testify. Come up in the spot looking come extra up. Fly. For the day I die, I'ma touch the sky. Back when they thought pink polos would hurt the ride.
I'm back! Yes! So last time I was on the stage teaching y'all, I said, listen, you got to make sure that I make a good impression on Pastor Eric so I can come back. Well, guess what? We did it. Yeah. Feel like I could touch the sky. Y'all with me? How's everybody doing today? I'm going to take this off real quick. Man, you ever just wake up one morning and you just feel so, so good, right? You are just like, man, I could testify. Like, I look in the mirror and I'm thinking to myself, how did you do that? Like, man, look at you. You're so good looking. How did you do that? And then, you know, like, it's just like you just, man, this is crazy today. You guys ever have a crazy day? All right. So, Pastor Robbie, can you help me out with this, please? Thank you so much. All right. So you wake up and you look at yourself in the mirror and you're like, how did you do that? You're looking so good, right? And let me tell you a little bit about my story. So I lived with my grandparents for a while, and I spent some time with my uncle, and he's only 9 years older than me. So he's like basically my older brother. We lived in the same room. He picked on me. He used me to get girls while he was dating in high school. True story. He would have that cute, this is my nephew, you know? Like, that was going to help him get ladies. I mean, it did. It worked, I guess. But anyway, he was like the classic ugly duckling that became the beautiful swan. Because, man, when that guy came out, he was just a little chubby. I'm telling you, he was kind of a mess. But then he started working out, he started wrestling, and I tell you today that he became this Greek god of fit, like he was like the underdog that rose to the top like a phoenix from the ashes. And he had this ritual that I thought was just so hilarious that he would do either in the morning or at night. He would go in and he'd look at himself in the mirror and he'd go, look at that, look at that. And then he'd go, Mary had a little. It's just flexing all over the place, this guy. And it still cracks me up when I think about it. But how many of you know sometimes self-love is really good? Like, we need to like love ourselves. Sometimes you need to look in the mirror and be like, you got it going on, boy. You know what I'm saying? But sometimes you wake up and you're like, oh, how did you do that? You feel bad about yourself, right? You know, and you're thinking, well, I know what I'm supposed to do, right? If you have a modicum of motivation, you know the right things to do, right? You know that you need to exercise. You know that you need to eat more veggies. Probably you need to eat smaller portions. You need some routine checkups. You need to take some supplements. Sometimes you need to treat yourself. Like mani, pedi, massage. Some of you love those massages. I know I do. And sometimes the best way to take care of yourself is to take a nap. I need that nappy nap. Like today, I'm gonna get one today. It's gonna happen. So we could end this message right here because we all kind of have this sense of we know the right stuff that we're supposed to be doing. We know that if you want to become and remain healthy, then do a variation of any of these things and you'll live a better, healthier, longer life, right? And maybe you've heard this scripture before, and this is in 1 Corinthians. It says, do you not know that your body is a temple of the Holy Spirit within you, whom you have from God? You are not your own, for you were bought with a price. So glorify God in your body. Now, some of us that grew up in church, when we read this scripture, it reminded us of all the things that we were not supposed to do. It reminded us of this phrase, maybe a variation of this phrase that you've heard. Don't drink, don't smoke, don't cuss, don't hang out with people that does. And it's kind of a bummer because it's like, why does everything have to be about what I can't do? Like, is God just about all the stuff I can't do with my body? Maybe, you know, you felt that's made you feel really guilty when you think about that scripture. Your body's a temple. It feels very serious, right? And even if it is or isn't, it doesn't solve the problem, because there seems to be this disconnection between our bodies and our disciplines, between our bodies and our hearts, and maybe even our bodies and God. So where does that disconnection come from, and why do we struggle? Because we want to be better. And sometimes, you know, you roll over in bed in the morning, and the first thing you grab is your phone, and then you look at Facebook and Instagram, and that doesn't make you feel any better. There's a lot of body shaming going on right now. Am I right? But the truth is that people come in all shapes and sizes and colors, right? So there's no one fit size all here. So shouldn't we celebrate that? Shouldn't we celebrate the best version of you no matter what size, shape, or color that you come in? I think so. So if we take a look at the spokes, we can see this about our relationship with these things, God and work and people, health. It's all one wheel. It's all you. But it's all connected. It all works together, which means that our health is actually a part of our spiritual lives. So we have to view it this way. And after hearing Pastor Eric's message last week, was anybody here last week? Did you hear Pastor Eric speak? Awesome. He spoke about our purpose, that God had given us a purpose. And if health is connected to our relationship with God and the work that our life's calling is supposed to be, that means our health should promote a healthy pursuit of that purpose. So I want to talk to another group of people in here. You might be a fitness buff. And I just want to tell you that you might want to check out through this message, because you are convinced that your disciplines are up to par. Your temple looks good. But just because your temple looks good, that doesn't mean that you're inviting God into the process of your fitness life. Because God wants to be involved in the way that you take care of your body. He wants to guide you and help you and inspire you and fill you up with passion. He fills us with fire to take care of ourselves as much as he fills us with the passion to know God and stay locked in to the purpose we were created for. Pastor Eric kind of framed it this way when he said in Ephesians 2:10 last week, "For we are God's handiwork, created in Christ Jesus to do good works, which God prepared in advance for us to do." You're God's handiwork, which means that you're created. You're created with love, created with purpose. And that means all shapes, all sizes, all colors. We're created with love. You know, just like that song, Good Grace, you guys digging that song? I really like it a lot. It says that he's madly in love with you. He's madly in love with this person he created. And so if our life's work is to pursue God's purpose for our lives as fully devoted followers of Christ, then in order to pursue it, we got to make sure that we are physically able to pursue it. And that starts inside and out. And by the way, there is nothing better than pursuing God's purpose for your life. So we have to be fit inside and out to pursue his purposes well. So hard work is the real more that all of us long for, and our calling and our purpose is God's promise of living healthy lives that build the kingdom. So everything starts with the heart, starts with what's in here. As my wife says, you'll never be satisfied with the promise if you don't do the more, meaning the way you pay attention to your heart positively impacts your relationship with your body, and the Spirit speaks to us and directs us in finding and deepening that connection. So whether you are a healthy person in here today, or you want to be, or are working on becoming one, it doesn't matter. We all have ruts. We all get to these places where we feel stuck. Just feel stuck in here, feel stuck with this body, right? And we feel stuck because the truth is, sometimes we get older, sometimes we get injured, and sometimes life happens, right? And life changes something within us and something outside. It makes us feel disconnected with ourselves, within ourselves, and that can translate to feeling disconnected on the outside. We need some help. Maybe you felt like what Paul wrote in Romans. He says this, "I do not understand what I do, for what I want to do, I do not do, but what I hate, I do." And maybe you're screaming out, "Who's going to rescue me from this body of death?" Well, I've got a really good answer, and this is in Romans 2. It says, "Thanks be to God who delivers me through Jesus Christ our Lord." Isn't it great? God delivers us inside and out. So does God care? Absolutely. But is it easy to be skeptical? It is. Because sometimes things aren't just working right. And when you get, when things aren't working right, you get discouraged, get angry. So last summer, which would be almost a year ago, I was looking in the mirror and I was thinking, like, ugh, what did you do? How did you do this? And at this point in my life, I'd weighed more than I ever had. And it was really discouraging because I played soccer most of my life, believe it or not. In fact, my mom actually called me an athlete about a week ago. And for some reason, that was sort of shocking to me. I think because, and I think this is true for a lot of people. Sometimes the things that we spend the 10,000 hours to accomplish, we don't claim being an expert because we aren't at a certain level of notoriety. And I don't think that's what God intended, especially when it comes to living out and working out his purpose for your life, which means this. Some of you think that you're not a minister of the gospel because you're not on staff at a church. But the truth is, you're just as called as me, even though I get a paycheck, right? True story. So I encourage you, start looking at yourself as a gospel bearer, as a good news bringer, right? You've got a purpose. So I was really like trying to figure all this out because I wanted to do my purpose well, whether that was be on staff at a church or not. I was gonna bring the gospel. I was gonna bring the good news of Jesus to somebody. But I was struggling. My body wasn't working properly. And so I needed to really dig into this. And so I did what we should do. And that's this. If you remember a few series ago, Dear Future Me, we talked about finding yourself on the map. Where are you in the journey? What happened behind you? What are you looking at that's ahead of you? And so I started to look back and sort of catalog my life experience. And I found out a few things. I had lived a very full decade, for sure, because I had so much going on the positive end of the spectrum and so much going on the negative end of the spectrum. On the positive end of the spectrum, I got married. I had kids. I transitioned from being a high school English teacher to being a full-time artist, singer-songwriter. My wife and I just started an artist development company. A lot of great things. But on the negative end of the spectrum, I experienced the aftermath of Hurricane Katrina and helped rebuild my hometown. And that was a lot of weight. I moved 6 times, and I struggled to put food on the table a few times. In fact, there was one point in my life, a period in my life, where I worked 4 jobs just to keep things going. And I experienced divorce, death, and falling out within my nuclear family and my intimate community all within that decade. I left the church, and I saw another one basically dissolve. So when I considered all of those things, I realized what the scientists say, that I shouldn't have made it out alive. Studies show that, who knows what I should have been. My marriage certainly shouldn't have made it out because of all those life stretches and changes, right? So my weight was fluctuating like crazy during this period. So I was trying to figure out, well, is that like my metabolism? Like, or was that like because of all this stuff that was happening? Couldn't quite put my finger at it. Because, you know, I saw that I was fighting for the purpose that God had given us. And I assumed that, you know, I knew that there was a cost, but maybe I just didn't know how deep the cost was. And I, you know, at certain points I had to acknowledge when I was reflecting that I was living a combination of denial, survival, and disbelief, okay? If you're familiar with the ancient personality assessment called the Enneagram that monks kind of created a long time ago, I'm a 7, which means that I'm an enthusiast. So when I'm surviving things, I tend to like distract myself or like create a world of hope around me. It's like a cocoon. So when I'm at, sometimes when I'm really struggling, I'm much healthier now. Thank you. There was a season in my life that I was like helping a lot of people out so that I wouldn't have to deal with what was going on in me. And then when I was at my worst, it was kind of something like this.
Now stand aside, worthy adversary.
'Tis but a scratch.
A scratch? Your arm's off.
No, it isn't.
Well, what's that then?
I've heard worse.
You liar!
Come on, you pansy!
is mine. We thank thee, Lord, that in thy mercy... Ah! Oh!
Come on, then.
What? Hang at you! You are indeed brave tonight, but the fight is mine.
Oh, had enough, eh?
Look, you stupid bastard, you've got no arms left.
Yes, I have.
Look!
It's just a flesh wound.
Look, stop that!
Chicken! Chicken!
Look, I'll have your leg. Right!
Right, I'll do you for that.
You what?
Come here!
What are you gonna do, bleed on me?
I'm invincible!
You're a loony.
The Black Knight always triumphs! Have at you! Come on, then. All right, we call it a draw.
So here I am fighting for the dream. I'm taking the hits. And it's just a flesh wound, you know? But there was something going on deep inside me that I wasn't paying attention to. I was distracting myself. And this is more than just my metabolism, right? These were some heavy life things that I was not facing. And while that's happening, I can't tell you how many times I tried to fix it, right? I did P90X at least 3 times. I did paleo 3 times. I went to CrossFit a couple times. I cleansed or whatever. Like, you guys know what I'm talking about. And it's like, it's okay for a time, and then I go back. So why do I keep going back? Why do I keep not working properly? I got to the point where I started disliking myself. You know, maybe you've gotten there too, where you're like me and you're standing in front of the mirror and you're just like, I don't know what to do. So what I chose to do is what this proverb tells us. Trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways submit to him and he will make your path straight. I said, God, I'm over it. What do I do? And I was choosing to believe that God cared about this part of my life, which on the flip side is a really great thing about being a 7, being the enthusiast, is that I believe in real hope, had a real hope that God really cared. And as I started to dialogue and pray about this, I started to realize, well, of course my body was a wreck. Look at what I'd gone through. Who wouldn't be a wreck? And so I prayed more, and he invited me into a fast. Now, when we talk about fasting, some of us are just like, all right, you want me to cut stuff out? Like, why? What's the point, right? And I was trying to figure that out myself. I was actually talking to my wife about this the other day, and she told me that there is a difference between intentional starvation and fasting, okay? Starvation is beating your body into submission and striving to make it do what you want it to do. And it's a negative form of control or deprivation. On the other hand, fasting, this is what fasting does for us. On the other hand, is removing distractions in your life so that you can bear witness to know your need or hunger for God, for joy, for peace, for love and hope. Fasting is a form of surrender and trust that God will satisfy the needs of your soul, and that will give eternal life to your entire being, including your body. And so what God was actually inviting me into is, hey, cut a couple things out so that you can open more space to be aware of how you feel and what I'm saying to you, and fill up on, you know, what I'm speaking to you and what the Bible is saying to you about me and about our relationship. And so I like to liken this idea of fasting to spiritual muscle confusion. If you've done anything like workout or done fitness, you hear about muscle confusion. And basically the idea is that if your body does a certain thing for a long amount of time, it eventually stops responding to it because it's so used to this activity. For example, I played soccer a lot, so I ran a lot, but eventually I had to change out the way that I was working out because my body was so used to running that I didn't lose like I used to. So with fasting, spiritual muscle confusion, because we're carving out space for God to fill. And we're doing it with sometimes food, sometimes social media, you know, any number of things. If something is a distraction to you, maybe just take it out for a little while. And instead, what I was doing is I was moving toward God so that he could move toward me. This is called the idea of compound motion. And the way that I was moving toward God, it was I was praying, I was reading the scriptures, I was reading good books. I was sitting in silence and just being aware of how my body felt. And if I promise, if you do that, your body will speak to you. It will tell you where the pain is. It will tell you how you're feeling and how you're doing, what's your progress. And you know, what God told me is there was no time frame on this. And the thing is I was ready for that. I was at a hinge point in my life. I needed a change. And I was like, God, I'm yours. Just tell me what to do so we can change this. So I ate cleaner. I basically went paleo. I was choosing to be present in my body. I cut down on some chocolate and some carbs. And, you know, while I was doing that, I was like, what does it really mean to be the temple? Like, we talked about your body is a temple, but what does that actually mean? And I didn't have the exact answer just yet, but I was working on it. And in the course of all of this happening, we have a really good friend who suggested that I go see a nutritional wellness specialist. So I was like, okay. By the way, she's a believer. I was like, that's even better. So I went to see Marianne. Shout out to Marianne, by the way. And she said, she did some tests, and she said, okay, Quinn, you have been living, she's real intense. You've been, she's Southern. You've been living uphill for so long, just like that. And I just need to tell you, Quinn, I'm serious, this one, she talks like, you've got adrenal fatigue. We're gonna take care of that. And then I was like, okay. And then she's like, I've got one more thing I need to tell you. It's like a combination of being Southern Nick Cage. The Nick Cage impression on SNL. It's like the exact same thing. It's like, so you've got, you know, anyway, I'm getting off track here. And I gotta tell you this, Quinn. You have a parasite. I was like, what? Parasite? What? She's like, tell me about your history. I was like, okay. So I told her, like, you know, I moved a lot, and I told her about Hurricane Katrina. She's like, that's it. And I was like, what? She's like, Quinn, that water table was really weird back then, and you probably got something then. And I was like, oh. So you mean to tell me I've had this thing for a decade? I didn't even know it? And she was like, yeah. And so I was like, this is crazy. So no wonder, like, I'm going through all this life stuff and my weight is fluctuating every 5 seconds. So weird. Here she is. I feel like sent from God to deliver this message to me. And so I was like, okay, well, what do I need to do? She's like, gave me some supplements. And then she said, I need you to eat differently. I was like, oh, boy. Like, how? She's like, well, what's your diet like? And I told her. She's like, perfect. Keep doing that. I was like, okay, cool. But take out this, 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 and this. I was like, okay. Well, for how long? 5 months. And I was like, what? Like, I was not expecting that. And so I can tell you in the process that I've been very hangry. And I've had a lot of FOMO. In fact, everyone that has been around me during this time, they like stay away from me at certain times because they know I'm going to be a little grumpy. But I'm happy to tell you that this past April, I'm clean. No parasite. Parasite free. Thank you, Jesus. And my next steps now are just to, I'm actually going to kind of stay on the diet I'm on. It's been good for me. And I'm being merciful to my body. I'm starting out to be a little active again, and that looks like taking a walk most days, and I started doing some push-ups again, and that might not seem like a lot to people. It might not seem like I'm really committed, but my body's been a wreck for a long time, and I really need to be gentle on it. And so I actually prayed and asked the Lord, Lord, what do you want me to do? How do you want me to be active again? And that's what he told me. Take a walk, do a couple push-ups, and it's been really super good for me. Now, because of this experience, I believe that when we live healed and whole to the degree that is in our power to, that we are living out heaven on earth. That we are showing the world that we are God's handiwork when we honor the life and the bodies that God gave us. And that when we do, we are able to live out our purpose in greater measure, because what is healed and whole on the inside gives new life to what is on the outside. Now, some of you might be here today. I want to speak to a particular group of people. And you're in here and you're hearing my message and you feel really discouraged. And maybe you feel discouraged because you have a condition or a debilitating disease, or you're wrestling with mental illness. And you're just doing, your mental health. And you're doing everything you can to do what the doctor is asking you to do. And I just want to say that we validate your experience. This experience for me, while it doesn't even compare, not even close to what some of you might have struggled with, I have a modicum of empathy. And we see you, we know you, and you are loved. But what I'm about to talk about, I hope will be really helpful to you. Because I believe that even so, even if you're struggling with those kinds of things, that you can still work on your heart. And that can give you the courage and the hope and the love and the joy that you need to work through those things. Because on the inside and the outside, we are all God's handiwork, created in Christ Jesus to do good works, which God prepared in advance for us to do. And taking care of ourselves inwardly and outwardly honors God for creating us. So again, my health is a part of my spiritual life, whether that's inside or outside. Let me put it another way. No matter what shape you were born with, no matter if you are well or not, whether you are on your way in or on your way out, the way you love and care for your body in all seasons says a lot about the way you know and love God. So doing our best to take care of our bodies and our spirits is an act of worship. Remember, Paul said, "Do you not know that your body is a temple?" Right? The Holy Spirit is within you. I kind of want to focus on that for just a second. Your body is a temple. First of all, what the scripture tells us, if you're following Jesus, your body's not your own. It doesn't belong to you anymore. You're a steward. This is a gift that you have to take care of. But this is the amazing part. When we think of a temple, we think of a sacred space, right? A place where the natural and the supernatural meet. And that's what Paul is saying. My body is the place where the natural and the supernatural intersect. I'm the place where heaven on earth happens. You're the place where heaven on earth happens. And not only that, he says his spirit lives within us. So what that means is that all that creativity and goodness and healing, power, purpose, resurrection life, it's inside of you. Which means that we have access to all that stuff anytime we want it. And that's why we have to take care of these bodies, so that we carry it well. Paul says it another way like this in Romans 12. He says, "Therefore, I urge you, brothers and sisters, in view of God's mercy, to offer your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and pleasing to God. This is your true and proper worship." So we like to say around here that worship happens when we respond to all that God is with all that we are, which means that when God shows up in our life and gives us love and hope and peace and joy, we receive Jesus' death and resurrection, that because we're so grateful, we give everything we've got, mind, body, and spirit, all working together to give ourselves to him, to be about his purpose, to align ourselves with who he is and what he wants us to do. So what we do with our body shows God and others who we belong to, and that we are grateful for who he is and what he's done for us, whether being our healthiest selves with family and friends and work associates, and even when we throw down during services. When we throw down during services. Listen, I have this saying, if I didn't sweat, I didn't worship. I worship hard, whether that's on this stage or out in life, because God is worthy for me to sweat it out. Because he's done so much for me. He's given up his life. He's given me his life. So why wouldn't I give him mine? Why wouldn't I, no matter what it costs, why wouldn't I? Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your might. This means that mind and body and spirit working together, get together to give God everything. So no matter where or what I'm doing my best to be the space where the natural and the supernatural meet up, to be the space where heaven on earth happen. You know, praise is a party. A lot of people don't think of that word praise as party. Like we come into church and we kind of feel bad about ourselves. We feel guilty because we know we're supposed to be better. But what's funny is, like, in the original language, there's seven Hebrew words for praise. So whenever you see the word praise in Scripture, there's a Hebrew word connected to it. And all of those words are actions. They're the lifting of hands. One is the shout, right? One is to get on my knees. One is to clap, right? And I think that there's a huge connection between being active and being connected to God. That's why those words for praise are like that. So what I'm trying to get at too is that science tells us that when we are active, it opens our minds up and our hearts, right? Some people have like if you've ever heard of runner's high, some people get like amazing ideas when they've like worked their body up by running. And so what I'm thinking is like our spirit, like our heart connection with our body, our heart connection with the Lord, when we are active, that we have the opportunity to be very connected to God. And we call this prayer. You know, I think sometimes we got to take prayer out of the box. A lot of us think of prayer as like, I've got to be on my knees with my hands folded and my eyes closed, and I have to talk like this and these and thous and thank you, Lord, and we just pray for the community. I just pray for the Subway sandwich that I'm about to devour after this service. Lord Jesus, thank you. It's wonderful. You know, but... But here's the deal. Prayer is an open conversation with God. That's it. It's listening. It's awareness. It's deep gratitude. It's being present with Him and with others and feeling the fullness of meaning and relationship. And it's sharing your thoughts with Him verbally. And it's echoing the words of Scriptures. And it's singing. And you can do all of that and be active at the same time. So what that means is that I can be praying and being active at the same time. In fact, it's a good thing to do together, right? And so if you're trying to figure out how to make that happen or like what you need to do next, I encourage you, ask God. He's ready to tell you. Remember, the principle of compound motion. James puts it this way. Come near to God and He will come near to you. Move, literally, move toward God. Run toward God. Walk toward God. Whatever you got to do. And if you need some ideas, I'm going to give you some. Go to the beach. Have a conversation with God as you like look at this incredible place that we live. Like let your heart be full of gratitude when you look at creation and that God created it for us to enjoy. Go for a run. Listen to a great worship playlist or throw on YouVersion and listen to the Psalms. If you're connected to a soap group in this church, maybe you do your scripture of the day while you go for a run. Take a long walk with your family or friends. There's nothing more like life-giving or godly than that sometimes. I think we need to take prayer out of the box. I can be praying and talking to someone at the same time. I can be aware of what God is saying to me and say it to them, and I can be aware that God is speaking through them and speaking to me, right? Do some yard work. Some of my best ideas have come from mowing the lawn. Just don't tell my wife, because I might have to do it more. Join a CrossFit group. Don't look at me like that. She's here, guys. Sorry. Join a CrossFit group. Sometimes we need community to encourage us, you know, and challenge us to keep pushing. And when we're pushing ourselves physically, it teaches us how to push ourselves spiritually, to want the more, to fight for the more. I was actually talking to Pastor Eric, and he told me about a story that he was running a marathon, and he had a conversation with God where he was almost to the finish line, and he so wanted to give up. And he was like, God, what do I do? And God gave him this little nugget. He said that when you're just almost to the finish line, that's the most important time to push. That's what Jesus did for us. Remember the Garden of Gethsemane. Lord, don't like take this cup from me. But if you won't, I'll do what you ask me to do. And some of us need that push. Some of us need to push to the finish line, and it's hard. And sometimes working in a CrossFit group can help out with that. Okay? My wife told me this the last time I can say this. Pray with your spouse. It's mutually beneficial to both of you. Yeah, just let that sink in a moment. Have a healthy meal. You know, taste the flavors. Be aware of the flavors. Be thankful for the flavors. Be thankful that maybe you chose to eat something that's more on the healthy side of things. Like, it can be really good. One of the most amazing meals I've ever had is like sweet potato, kale, pesto, and walnuts. Is that right? Okay, I totally got it wrong. But it's really good. It's very comforting. then, like, you know, another thing, and this is one of my favorite things, go dance. Get jiggy with it. Like, have some, you know, I think a healthy church is a church that dances. Okay, because we have a lot to celebrate. We don't need to be down all the time. And this is another reason why. God dances. How do I know that? Let's look at Zephaniah 3:17. The Lord our God is with you, the mighty warrior who saves. He will take great delight in you. In his love, he will no longer rebuke you, but will rejoice over you with singing. This word rejoice in the Hebrew means that he like shouts and spins. He like touches the sky. It's like, oh, those are my kids. Yeah, come on, come on, come on. And so you mean to tell me that that's the truth? And then we do, praise the Lord. Come on. Praise is a party. Like, if my God parties, I'm going to be up in that party. I want to give him, if that's what he's doing for me, then how much more should I do it for him? It's good stuff. So here's the best part. I just talked about how you are his handiwork. And he loves you so much that he rejoices over you with singing and shouting. It's a beautiful picture of how heaven and earth can meet when I'm active and when I'm connected and when I'm listening and when I'm moving with him in everyday life. So could you guys stand with me for just a second? So I want to ask you a few questions to wrap things up. This is the first one. Maybe you've heard my message today and you need to ask yourself this question. How can you invite God to guide you in your active lifestyle? Here's a second question. How can you make eating and exercising an act of worship? What do you need to change about your eating and exercising so that you stay on mission? Remember, you've got a purpose. So we should be eating and exercising to be on purpose. And then maybe you should ask yourself, what is your next step? Maybe it's to touch the sky.
I gotta testify.
Come on.
Come up in the spot looking extra fly.
Come on.